Hi, I'm Victoria Mullen, and I'm with WKTV Voices, and I'm here with Julian. Could you say your name and spell
Julian,
it?
Julian Voss Andre, Voss hyphen Andreae.
Okay, great. And you have an art prize piece in finals. Could you explain exactly? Is it the jurors or was it the vote?
It's the public vote.
Okay.
And it's one of the 3D pieces. And it's a large female figure made out of slices in front of the Grand Rapids Public Museum.
Okay, yep, I've seen the pictures. Mm. That's great. So, okay, tell me, where are you from originally?
I grew up in Germany, okay. In Hamburg.
And when did you come to the States?
I came to the States in 2000, to Portland, Oregon, and that's where I still am.
Okay, and what brought you to the States?
The woman who then became my wife.
That's a good reason.
Yeah. That's right.
Is she an artist as well?
No, not at all. She's also a former scientist, actually.
Oh, wow.
She was a neuroscientist, and she inspired my work quite a bit because of her research.
That's interesting. So how long have you been making art?
Well, I mean, I started out as a kid, obviously, like everybody, but then I was very serious about it when I was 17 and 18. I meant to become a painter at that time and drew a lot and did oil paintings and stuff, but... Then I studied physics, so I forgot about the art for a while, or didn't do it anymore. Didn't forget it, but didn't do it. And then a few years later, I enrolled into art college when I moved to the US, and then I started with sculpture kind of suddenly, which had never been something that was interesting to me, but then suddenly it became really interesting.
So how did that become interesting to you?
It's funny because I did my research in physics and my 8 years of physics in different universities, and I got exposed to like certain ideas and certain three-dimensional things, and also on the way to biomolecules. And so when I stopped science and enrolled into art college in the US, one of the first things was that we had to rearrange a long piece of lumber into mitered cuts. And so basically take one and cut it up and glue it back together. And so when I saw this thing, I felt reminded of proteins. That's exactly how life goes from one-dimensional DNA to three-dimensional bodies, by making protein peptide chains, basically, that fold up into space. So I set out to make sculptures based on that idea, protein sculptures. Oh. And so that's when I got really into sculpture at that time.
That's interesting. So do you do anything with your science background now?
Yes, I do, actually. I'm involved in a collaboration with scientists at Caltech and New York University, which is an ongoing thing, where they're trying to use DNA as building block material. So they're interested in my input from the 3D kind of world. So I still have something to do with science, but not usually on the research paper level, mostly on a more meta level, which is more fun anyway.
That is fun. Mm. So it's not often that you see somebody that's able to blend their left brain and their right brain.
No.
So how do you do that? Do you get confused sometimes?
I don't know. It's like I wouldn't know really how other people feel, you know, about the world. But I'm left-handed. Maybe it has to do with that. For me, it has been always very... When I was a kid, I had like these scientific hobbies like electronics and computer and programming and chemistry. I did like a big lab in my room. But I also would like do pottery and drawing. And I never felt of it as a different thing. I was driven by the aesthetics of it. In essence, you know, I was driven by the sense of wonder, you know, that's what got me going in both of those. So I felt they were very related.
So now, is anybody else in your family artistic?
Yeah, totally. They're not very scientific. It's like, in fact, my parents both, they are totally into music and into painting, like classical painting and stuff. They don't do it themselves, but they're great art connoisseurs. It's been like a huge part of my upbringing, the arts. In fact, when I told my father that I wanted to study physics and gave up on the art plans, he was really disappointed and tried to talk me out of it, which is pretty unusual, I think, for parents. Most would tell their kid to study physics, please, and not art, but he was the opposite.
So are you the only kid in your family?
No, I have two siblings.
Okay, are they artistic as well?
Not that they're professional artists, no.
Okay, so now you said professional artist. Does that mean you make a living from your
art?
You do? Mm-hmm. Okay, so explain to me, do you do commissions? Do you teach?
Yes.
What do you do?
No, I don't teach. Since 2004, I graduated in 2004, and I basically gave myself like a few years to see if I can make a living off it. And then in 2007, I was at that point where I decided, okay, I'm going to do this full time and don't teach and don't do what most other artists do. And so instead, I focused all my effort and time into basically reaching out to galleries, trying to find good people who would be able to represent my work. And so from then on, it kind of grew. So now I have several galleries, so I make pieces for galleries. And at the same time, I do these public art commissions. So, I work with people and stuff spins off. So, you know, stuff has been happening all the time.
That's great.
Yeah.
So, okay, I just had a thought and it went away. Maybe it'll come back.
Yeah.
So tell me about Art Prize. Is this the first Art Prize that you've entered?
Yes, it's the very first time. I saw it years ago already. I had it on my radar for a while, and I always thought it's so intriguing that what you guys are trying to do here is to kind of counterbalance basically this rarefied academic art world, mm-hmm. and balance it with a public vote. And I thought this is totally cool. And so I always thought it would be nice to like put a piece here. And so this year it worked out for the first time.
Okay, now your piece is pretty big. How did you get it here?
On a trailer.
So you actually pulled it here?
Yeah, I didn't drive it, but there was a guy I hired who did this.
Okay.
Because I couldn't face driving such a long distance. It would drive me crazy.
Oh my goodness. Mm. How much does your piece weigh?
It weighs 3,500 pounds.
Oh my goodness. Okay.
Mm.
So it's
kind of an ordeal to install it and haul it.
I was going to say.
It's doable. Yeah.
Doable.
Yeah.
So do you start with like a little model of what you want to create? Or how?
In this case, this has been... I mean, this approach has been developed over the last 12 years, but this very shape has been around for me since 2015. And I started out with a 3D scan of a human model. And then I work on it on the computer and kind of make it right for what I like it, what I want to do with it. And then I, apply a number of different kind of software kind of things, computer algorithms, to get it to a point that I can actually laser cut and fabricate it. So there was a gallery version, a life-size version of her, that was an edition that's, I think, sold out now. And so this is the first time we made that in big. But we essentially used the same shape with some edits, like there's twice the now amount, number of pins, for example, to make it structural. And then also she's hollowed out because I want to have the light come in from below.
So did you fabricate this yourself? Did you have help with it?
Yeah, I have help. I have people who work with me. So we're kind of a whole team in my studio, and we kind of do this together. It takes hundreds of hours, so you couldn't even do this if you wanted to alone.
Right.
It's like always a team effort, basically, all sculpture.
How many people do you have working with you?
On the order of 3-4. It depends a little bit, yeah.
Okay. And then tell me about, describe the piece to me and what you want people to get from it.
Okay. So... first of all, it's a 10-foot tall female figure in a kneeling pose with her hands on her hips, thighs, like this.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a very meditative kind of pose with the gaze straight out. And so the idea that was originally inspired by my physics research is that I take slices of the figure with gaps in between. So when you go in front of her and cross the direction of her gaze, then she appears to disappear, basically. Because you see almost all air and almost no steel in that one angle. And that's a pretty fun effect because you can kind of like walk around and see how it materializes and dematerializes. And you can also take your kid and put her on the lap and then take a photo such that the child seems to float on her lap, so in the air, which is really cool. And people really like that. So, I mean, one is like where the inspiration come from, but the other is like, I feel pretty strongly about wanting to have people have different, interpretations or feelings. It shouldn't be that you have to read the artist's statement and then, oh, that's what the artist tries to tell us. That's not what I'm trying to do. I want people to enjoy it, to have a sensual engagement with this piece, and then maybe spin off some intellectual interpretations.
Okay, what would
those can be different. Like,
yeah.
For example, one is that's close to my heart is that, we are essentially... one, we experience ourselves and the others as individuals. We are one fabric of life. And so if we make a human in this kind of ephemeral, kind of ghost-like style, it seems to me expanding like a quantum object and become like not just that person, but an aspect of something much bigger. You know, that's one thing. Another thing is, I'm, you know, intrigued by this thing that since Descartes, he invented the Cartesian coordinate system. And we are kind of, we think that's how it is, but it's actually not at all. We impose this Cartesian coordinate system onto nature. We have an organic shape, and then we slice things up. That's how we do physics, how we do all science. And analysis means we basically take it apart. And that's kind of a dangerous endeavor. It's incredibly powerful. It's incredibly rewarding. And it yields things like iPhones, which is wonderful. But also, it's kind of, it's ultimately a destructive process. And we have to be very careful to put together, you know, reconnect the dots, if you will, and put together a way of looking at the world. And we see, you know, with the environmental destruction, that we were not very good at this so far.
It's true. So what's the title of your piece?
It's Quantum Meditation.
Ah, so that makes, I mean, what you described to me.
Makes sense.
Makes sense, yes.
Yeah, my wife gave me the title.
It was
Did
a good
she
idea. Really? Mm-hmm. So you guys kind of work as a team? As
not really, but she always has good ideas.
Yeah.
So I like to use those.
That's great. So do you have a family? I mean,
yeah,
we
have
kids?
Four kids.
Four kids.
Yeah.
Okay. Are any of them artists?
They're all artists. But,
they're all
you know,
artists.
In a wider definition, my son really loves video editing and he's very, very good at this. Then the next one up is a daughter. She is in Germany right now, went to boarding school there for this year. And she's very artistic, has beautiful sense for colors and drawing. Then number three is a total artist. She's like a conceptual artist mostly. I don't even know how to describe that. Number four, I'm not totally sure yet, but she's also very intrigued by everything that's beautiful and artistic. So they all have that sense for sure, yeah.
What are their ages?
They are 17, 16, 11, and 8.
Okay. Okay, nice little spread there.
Yeah.
That's cool. So what other projects are you working on now?
We have a number of gallery works that we are like working off. Basically, there's always a backlog. There's stuff that's being ordered, and then we make them. So there's one we're working on right now for Azerbaijan, which is a pretty similar piece, but not quite as tall. That's one that just came in. We need to do that really fast. Then there was a big male figure for South Africa, which we just finished pretty much almost. Then there's another one for a gallery. Another one for the island of, Aruba, I think.
Okay,
so that's
Aruba?
Really cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So you go there. Yeah. So those are the ones that are in the shop right now being made.
Okay. Yeah. So you have a shop and then...
And some crazy projects on the side.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
So you're strictly sculpture? You don't do any painting or drawing
anymore?
No,
not really. No.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
No.
Okay.
And then One day, maybe, but I just don't know where...
Right now, this is what you're doing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense. So tell me what galleries you are in.
Okay. So I work with a gallery, in Sun Valley. That's my oldest gallery, Frederick Bolloir. And then I have one in Palm Desert, in that area. Mm-hmm. It's Holman Fine Arts. And then one in San Francisco, that's Andrea Schwartz. And then I'm working with some newer ones and, you know, see how that goes.
So you do all your own marketing? And you?
So far, yes, yeah.
Okay, mm-hmm. So you go to galleries and you say, hey, I've got this portfolio.
Sort of. I mean, I try this and I'm not very good at this because it's like not something that I... enjoy per se, but I kind of, you know, I understood over time that this is also a creative endeavor and connected to what I'm doing. So I had to sort of force myself to sometimes reach out. But then if you reach a certain level, stuff falls into place and then it's more a skill to kind of ride the waves right.
That's interesting. Mm. Yeah. So tell me about your experience with Art Prize. Have you met any other artists that you are... impressed with? Or?
You know, I didn't even have time really to look at many other pieces. Mm-hmm. I was here to install and then I spent a few days in front of the sculpture. And my main thing that was like really impressive for me was to just interact with the people because everybody's super nice here. People, it's just, sculpting is a pretty lonely profession. Mm-hmm. But when you suddenly stand there and you see people interact with the work and go like, wow, this is so cool. You know, one after the other, that's just actually a really kind of a mind-blowing experience. So, and I enjoy that part really quite a bit. I have never had anything like this on that scale.
Really? Okay, so...
Not standing there with so many people, no.
Yeah.
Definitely not.
That must be interesting.
You know, I see the Facebook and the Instagram feedback, right. I see that. But to actually have an interaction with a human being is a bit different. And that didn't happen a whole lot.
Yeah. Now, are you surprised that you made the top 20 of the public vote?
I'm really happy about it. I'm not surprised. I don't know. You know, of course you're biased with your own work. You think it's the best ever since sliced bread, literally. So, but it's, you know, but knowing, you know, that being an artist is basically also a series of rejections. That's a big part of it, that you have to learn to, okay, you know, that doesn't fit, I move on. So I don't expect anything anymore. So I'm really, really kind of amazed, actually. It's wonderful.
It is wonderful. Mm. So, okay, I know a lot of artists, well, not a lot of them, but a lot of people I know they're very emotional, they get depressed. I mean, do you ever have that kind of problem if somebody rejects you or
yes,
you don't
but I
think
don't talk about it.
You don't talk
no,
about
no,
it.
No, of course I do. But I think we all do. It's just like, I think that, again, it's different. In the beginning, it's much, much harder because mm-hmm. you just have to have this almost insane belief in yourself, which is almost the opposite of your sensitivity. You have to be very sensitive, which means you understand that things can go wrong and you're not perfect. But you also have to have this kind of deep confidence, which is not something you can easily muster and generate, you know. So, and it's that's actually really hard for me. But when you move on in this whole thing and then climb up the ladder, it's more, there's so much stuff going on, and if I get an email saying, oh, you didn't get that, then there's already a million other things and I don't really care, or I don't even get to answer that email right away. So it just feels so different, you know, if everything is going nicely.
Yeah. So how long did it take to get there, you said?
Well, it depends. It's kind of goes in different layers. So this year was kind of new because I had for the first time some videos online, especially through Instagram, going viral, like 10 million views. And that just was kind of a game changer, because then suddenly I get these emails from all over the world and people who reach out, and that's kind of really exciting. But that hasn't happened before 2018 to that scale. You know, it was smaller, more local, more US, but now it's clearly going in a different direction.
So it sounds like this is your big breakout year.
You know, I don't know. As I said, I really take it one day at a time.
Right. Well, yeah. That's a good way to be. Hmm. So where did you come up with the initial confidence to really believe in yourself and just put yourself out there and, you know, go for it? Where did you find that?
I think it's a kind of a realization that I don't really want to do anything else. Hmm. You know?
Okay.
This is what I want to do. Just and I don't have much of a choice, in a way. You know, so I just, that's what I do, and I might do it, I do it full blast, because that way, I don't want to be at the end of my life, or and just at some point saying, oh, if I had done this, then I could have gone there. You know, I want to say, okay, I tried everything, and it worked out, I didn't.
Mm-hmm. So. That's amazing. So what do you want people to know about you as the artist?
Nothing. They should look at the piece. No, really, seriously.
Okay, but you are the creator of the piece.
Yeah, but it's, as I said, it's teamwork, you know. Yes, I do the design, and but we built this as a team. It's like, this is a huge team effort. And that's a big part of it, you know. It's a huge piece, it's welded beautifully. All that stuff I could never have done all by myself.
Right.
So, you know, that's the whole package counts.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if you were to not really compare yourself, but the time of today to when Michelangelo did his sculptures, how do you think that compares?
It's so different. He was like such a singular kind of person and talent, like Picasso. So, it's just, you know, he was just amazing. But it's been 500 years now. And so now we're in a very different time. We have different problems and different, you know, wonderful things like computers. Mm-hmm. I mentioned that before. So it's like, it's just the right thing to use that to make art, you know. It's just, we're beyond the chisel age, you know. Now the tools that the new tools have become so complex that you can actually, you know, work in an artistic way with them for the first time. It's been only, you know, a few years, basically.
Now
we have 3D printing, we have 3D scanning. It's a new day for sculpture right now. So Michelangelo is incredible, but it's just different, very, very different.
It is very different. Mm. So you mentioned before that you had this piece as a smaller version, and you had several of them, is that
yes.
right?
Yeah.
So you do like a limited edition?
Exactly, it's like six, for example, five to seven usually, which is like something that way you can actually, you know, hone them, but also make some money. Because otherwise, if you make one, it's basically impossible.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just because of the dynamics and the the constraints of the art market. It's the piece, if you get a living wage for something you do make one of and put in the gallery with that markup, it will cost so much money that almost nobody will be able to buy it. Right. So that's just part of the reality.
So how do you do that? How do you duplicate to do like six of these things?
Again, it's a new day for sculpture. Now you can program the computer, you can do all your drawing, refine it as much as you can, and then have a file that goes in, basically is a CNC machine that steers a laser to cut the steel. And then you can do the same thing again and weld it again. So it's like in the old days, there was only bronze casting. Bronze casting, you could do additions. Now it's different. You can actually fabricate a piece almost exactly the same, which is really cool, you know?
That is amazing.
Yeah.
So what kind of metal do you use?
It's mostly stainless. I use a lot of bronze. I use some titanium. And then I also use glass and other materials, but mostly stainless, just because it's holding up against gravity really well. It holds up against the weather. It's like an amazing material, you know, and it reflects the light beautifully. I'm not 100% fan of it. I some things I don't like about stainless, but it's an amazing material.
Okay. So is there anything else you want people to know about you and your art? Now's the time.
I don't know.
Don't know?
No.
Okay.
I think we covered quite a bit already.
Yeah.
Unless you have another question.
I'm just fascinated. I don't think so. I think we covered everything I wanted to cover. I just want to make sure that if I haven't asked you something that you want to cover.
No, I think that'll be most of it.
Okay. So I think that's it.